Hey, this is Pastor Curry, pastor of the East Zion Fair Baptist Church, Wilmington's most exciting church, the church that love you and ain't a thing you can do about it. Today, I'm excited. We're going to have an exciting show for you today. I've decided to ask those individuals in our church who will be putting on our, this year, we used to call it a cantata. I don't know what to call it. Maybe we'll call it Hollywood. I don't know. But whatever it is, we're going to bring the director, the musical director, as well as the directress who will be doing all of the art part of it. And we're just going to have a little fun, little conversation. And I hope and trust that each one of you will find the time. You'll see it on the screen very shortly to come and be a part of this production. It's going to be live. Who said COVID would take away the joy of Christmas? It's going to be live, it's going to be popping, and we'll be right back. And we're back. And we're back. Listen, I don't have my glasses on, I don't have my cup, but we get ready to have coffee with Curry. These are two creative, dynamic men of God. I'm looking forward to what they're doing. It's just got me excited. Who said Christmas would be lost given all the loss that we are experiencing with the coronavirus? Here at East Zion Fair, we're excited. Just this week, we had our live lighting of the campus, and each night I'm starting to feel the sense of Christmas all over again. And one thing we all know, who knows Kaelen and who knows Brother Morris, especially Kaelen at this point from East Zion Fair, when he puts on something, he gets on your last nerve, but it comes out right. He even bossing the pastor around. But as I told him, that's only for the next 2 weeks and it'll be over. Fellas, welcome to Coffee with Curry.
Thank you.
I just want to start because I'm so excited right now that how did you come up, Mr. Director, with this concept? And tell me a little bit about it.
Well, I don't really have an artistic process, so to speak. Literally, I'll be somewhere, stuff will just kind of just drop on me. Exactly how to do it, what should be, anything like that. So that's the same thing with this, just to kind of, what can we do to kind of bring Christmas to East Zion Fair in a different way? So the title is A Virtual Christmas with a question mark, meaning how are we doing this virtually? Because a lot of churches are doing it live and just recording it in a sanctuary, but we're totally doing something totally different. It's going to excite everybody.
Oh, wow. You think so?
Oh, I know so.
You know so?
Yes.
What's going on with you with this music stuff, mister?
Well, I tell you, this is something totally different for me. Doing a whole production virtually. Uh-huh. And I tell you, this has been the most exciting 3 weeks of my year. I mean, COVID hasn't stopped nothing. You know, this is the Christmas season. And, I refuse to be down at this point, and it's been an awesome time, awesome season that we're in, and I wanted to make sure that everybody feels that in this production. There's been a lot going on. We have, you know, people that are out there that are depressed, that are food lines, different things that are going on. We want them to feel the miracle of Christmas and it's the season of giving. We want to put that back in the excitement of people's hearts. And hopefully they can feel that through this production.
Are you with him?
Yes.
Are you agreeing with him?
I agree completely. That's my heart and everything.
Okay. Because normally, you know, Brother Kaelen, you like to make sure that give a serious tone to it. But I've been hearing some fun stuff may be happening.
Oh, absolutely. One room in the church was turned into a party room, not the sanctuary. But there is a scene in the production where it's like literally a party, there's line dancing, there's disco.
Oh.
Yeah.
In church?
Not in the sanctuary, but in a room of the church. It was transformed into a party room.
Oh, wow. I wonder if the pastor knew about that.
No. He knows now.
Oh, he does? Okay, we're going to have to give a talk with him.
The pastor does do a little dance, though.
Who? The pastor?
Yes.
The little short guy from...
Yes.
Oh, my gracious. I'm going to look forward to that. I'm coming. For no other reason, I'm coming for that. But listen, just so tell me, is there any little bits and pieces you can give me that will get me excited about coming to this production?
Think outside the box. You will not realize that things actually are happening in the sanctuary by the way things look.
Oh.
Also, there are... most of the songs have been rearranged by myself. There's one completely original song. that I think is pretty good. You think it's pretty good.
I do. So, I really do. I be singing it. And listen, my daughter told me, Daddy, what are you singing? I said, well, Kaelen got the notes. I just got the words right now. Well, that's good. Brother Jay, I mean, you kind of got me excited too when you were sharing how you are just excited about this out of your time being with us. This is a really highlight moment for you. Yeah.
Well, you know, there is a lot I won't say because I want the people to really understand. You need to come and see this production. Ezion, please. Y'all need to come and feel... feel the miracle and see what we're doing here. This is awesome. We've been in production mode for the last 3 weeks, working tirelessly. Long nights. Including tonight. Long days. No days off, really. And it's going to be going on and going on. And even after this is done, we're getting ready for Resurrection Sunday.
Oh, wow.
Which is coming up. So we have some awesome things going on, so I don't want anybody to get discouraged. Come out to church, come to the parking lot, come to the sanctuary, come see what's going on at our house, at Ezion Fair. We have some great things. The music is going to be lit. Dancing is going to be lit. The pastor dance is going to be lit.
Oh, wow.
So come on out. we want you guys, I hope that you guys feel the excitement that I am feeling right now. This is an awesome time, so come on out. Come on out.
Now, you said lit like 4 times, and for my senior citizens who are listening to us, help us, because that means different things to different people. So what do you mean by it's going to be lit? What does that mean?
Exciting.
It's going to be very exciting.
Oh.
Look, it's righteous.
Righteous, okay. Okay, all right.
It's going to be awesome, and, you know, I just want everybody to feel... you know, because we can't all be together like we're so used to live, you know, with the choir up there and the dancers in your face, and it's just, you know, we want you to still feel that
energy,
presence of Christmas.
Yeah.
Even through the production.
So they will.
Grab your cocoa on that day, you know, your marshmallows, and just come on, you know, and enjoy it with us.
Wow. Were you going to say something, Kaelen?
I said they will enjoy it.
They will
be moved, definitely.
And be moved. Okay, that's just awesome. And, I'm a little saddened because I know that Autumn was supposed to be a part of our conversation today, but she got tied up at her job, so she wasn't able to be here. But I know she is working really hard on the part that she's doing. What parts are she handling in this?
Autumn is always handling all the dancing and the choreography for the entire event.
Oh, is that why it's so whirly?
No.
Come on, defend her. Come on. You told me to turn into a party room and all this other stuff.
A Holy Ghost party room.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, so they're going to be having Kirk Franklin and James Cleveland.
Well, Lettucey does gospel too. Sometimes.
Oh.
Yeah, sometime.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. Yeah. Well, I hope I'm just excited about this. And this is on the 20th of November.
Yeah.
December the 20th here at Ezion Fair. So it's two showings. It's going to be a 9 in the morning, and it'll be outside in the parking lot, as well as those who want to come in the sanctuary.
Yep.
And then there will be a 11:30.
Yeah.
So you know they can hit either or and still be blessed. Or hit both, because it's going to be just that good, you think?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Man, I'm excited about this. Yeah, and I got a couple of serious things I want to ask y'all when we come back. So just give us a second. We're going to come right back. We'll be right back. And we're back. I just want to just take a couple moments and just, you know, I'm so excited. I can't even get words out. The campus is beautiful. The scenery that you all have presented is beautiful. I had an opportunity to be at a few of your rehearsals. Not too many, because Kaelen wants me to be surprised other than the stuff that I'm doing. But I just want to take an opportunity to say to Ezion Fair that, one, you're blessed to have such talented and gifted men and women of God, because even though Autumn is not here and a couple others who are working with them tirelessly, Ashley and others, I want you to know that you got some talented people who are doing some great stuff. And Kaelen, every year I get the opportunity to watch the productions here at Ezion Fair. I think like 4 years straight, you did the productions here. And there's always something in it that I really do treasure and take to heart. This year, when you asked me to participate with the one song that you wrote, I did not know you wrote it when you asked me to participate, but a child is born. And when I was listening to the words, I said, I like this song. I really like this song. And then you said, I know I wrote that, and I did not at the time, but now I really do like it. Tell me a little bit about your thoughts on when you wrote that.
Well, this time of year is kind of really emotional for me, ever since my mother passed. So while here, I'll try to like purposely entrench myself in production to kind of keep my mind on something else. Mm-hmm. Last year I was taking my sabbatical. So during that time frame, I had all these ideas and stuff just kind of built up and I had to let it out. Mm-hmm. So I remember driving to the gym and I just started tapping and humming. And I was like, oh, today a child is born in Bethlehem. Then why did he come? He came to restore our hope, to give us peace and to show us how to love each other.
Yes.
And that was the point of a child being born. It just kind of, the flow, that's how God kind of gives me stuff. It just kind of just flows and comes out, honestly.
You know, I've tried to stay serious, but you'll maybe jump me. God speaks to you? Oh, that's wonderful to know.
Of course.
just messing with you. You know, and Kaelen, I'm also proud to hear that you are now working on your PhD.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
And I admire you for that. I remember you as the 300-pound brother from Lincoln. Oh, did I say that on air? I didn't mean to say that. On Lincoln's campus, who was directing the choir and doing some great things with us there. But to see now you've finished your bachelor's, your master's, and now you're on that PhD level, I wish you well.
Thank you.
And I think that America will enjoy you. And Ezion Fair is enjoying you, but your gift will take you places and your character will let you stay. So I appreciate you for that.
Thank you.
Brother Morris, you had an opportunity to work with us for the last almost a year now, not quite a year, but you know, several months. What is this doing for you as a minister of music? Because I thank God for you. We've had many ministers of music and they have all been good. But now I just want to say, you know, what is this? How is this working with you?
I've always, you know, admired Kaelen, Gabriel Smallwood, Autumn Jones, the Jones girls, I call them, Jasmine, and Ashley. I've always admired, they call it the crew.
Mm-hmm.
And I always love their sound. I've always loved their love for this ministry.
Mm-hmm.
I loved working with them on the last recording.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like, this is just like coming home, for me. So getting to work with Kaelen Moore on a one-on-one basis, getting to see his genius and his creativity and how he portrays his ideas to me, and you know, it pushes me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it pushes what I do. And when I tell you, you know, I've been challenged,
mm-hmm.
you know, in a good way. You know, it's been amazing.
Yeah, I believe you immediately when you say you've been challenged, because if he's working with you, meaning Kaelen, he's going to challenge you. I watch him sometime because he'll try to challenge me, but he always looking to see what my reaction going to be. But everybody know Christmas time, you get away with anything with me. But that's just wonderful, and I'm glad to see the peace that God has given all of us as we're going through this. This is a very stressful time, not so much because of the production, but because we're living in a stressful moment, but yet y'all are making fun of it. I watched and I almost went into worship when I was watching one of the scenes that you were doing. I think it was with Ashley as she was singing. I mean, I was just feeling it. And so I agree with you, Kaelen, when you said you will feel the presence of the Lord, and I'm looking forward to that. I'm just looking forward to it. And I wanted to do a show last night as you all were rehearsing. I just said to the crew, I said, just tell them, the leaders, I need them to come to the show and let's just talk about it. Let's get the people excited about it, because God is going to do something great and is doing something great. And y'all have involved everybody.
Yes.
That's so critical. Yes. Y'all didn't just go with one praise team. All the men and all will be a part of this, and it's just thanks be, and we were COVID safe.
Yes.
That's what I love about it. And so we're gonna look forward to this, and I just hope everybody on Channel 28, everybody who's watching through our social media outlets, would just please make sure you come. Get here early so you can get a good parking space, because it's gonna fill up quick. And everybody who knows anything about our cantatas of the past know that we put on some very, very strong ones, and it's going to be live and popping. And as my brother said earlier, it's gonna be lit. Yeah, that's interesting, it's gonna be lit. Okay, the people from my era hear that, they're gonna think you're gonna Pastor Kavasi or something, but pray for them. But anyway, in saying that, I thank you so very much for both of y'all, and this is going to be fun. So I just hope and trust that you all will continue to do what you do. Know that the Lord will bless you, because we don't have the kind of money that it would take to pay you. So what we do is just give you a chicken dinner and say thank you. So thank you so very much. And listen, we appreciate you. All right. So we'll be right back. And God bless you. I thank God for Brother Kaelen and for Brother James for taking the time out to come and be a part of our show today. I just wanted you all to be excited about what we're doing here at East Zion Fair. Every person who's going to be a part of this Christmas cantata or this Christmas celebration are members of our church. And we wanted to make sure we highlighted every praise team we have. We wanted to highlight all of our soloists, our dancers, and God is going to move in a mighty way. We've had and going to have a lot of fun. For those of you who have been a part of our cantatas of the past, you know we don't just do traditional stuff. We do it and we have fun doing it. So I pray that you will show up on December the 20th at the 9 and the 11:30 time and watch God move in a mighty way. I love you and I praise God for you. And during this season of celebration of our Savior, I want you to let all your stress go and focus on the reason of this season, and that is Jesus Christ being born. God bless you, and heaven smile on you. Hey, this is Pastor Curry, pastor of the East Zion Fair Baptist Church, just reminding you that every Sunday at 9 a.m. we have our worship service, and then we have one at 11:30. Yes, we recognize it is still COVID, and we are not having full service in the sanctuary, but we are allowing a minimum amount of people in the sanctuary, and we are allowing the parking lot to be full. But many of you saying, Pastor, I really tried to get there and I wasn't able to get there. Well, for those of you who weren't able to make it last Sunday, this is what you missed.
Let's pray together. Eternal and all-wise Heavenly Father, give of every good and every perfect gift. God, we bless you today because you are so good. You are so faithful. You are so kind to us. And Father, as the old saint said, if we had 10,000 tongues, we would not have enough to praise and thank you. But God, with what we have, we want to give you praise. We want to give you honor, and we want to give you glory. Move now, God, in a mighty way. Strengthen somebody. Somebody came in the parking lot, came with their head down, but God, be the lifter of their head. Somebody came in the sanctuary stressed out, but God, let them leave with no stress. Father, the word of God is about to come forward to the people of God. Let the word of God heal. Let the word of God deliver. And let the word of God set us free. And Father, we promise you when this day is over, none of us, nobody, not myself or anybody, will take any credit, because all credit belongs to you. This is our prayer today in Jesus' name. And the people of God said amen and amen. Come on, let's celebrate the Lord one more time as you take your seats in the presence of the Lord. Go with me real briefly to the book of St. Luke chapter 17, the book of St. Luke chapter 17 and the 11th verse. St. Luke 17:11. Listen to what the word of the Lord says. As Jesus continued on towards Jerusalem, he reached the border between Galilee and Samaria. Verse 12, as he entered a village, then 10 lepers stood at a distance, crying out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." He looked at them and said, "Go show yourself to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed of leprosy. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, came back to Jesus shouting, "Praise God." He fell to the ground at Jesus' feet, thanking him for what he had done. This man was a Samaritan. Verse 17 says, Jesus answered, didn't I heal 10 men? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give glory to God except this foreigner? Verse 19, and Jesus said to the man, "Stand up and go. Your faith has made you whole. Stand up and go. Your faith has made you whole. It's in the top part of the text that I want to deal with today. There were 10 leprous men stood at a distance crying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." He looked at them and said, "Go show yourself to the priest." And as they went, they were cleansed of leprosy. Today, just for a few moments, I want to talk about lessons from a leper. Come on, look at yourself and touch yourself and say, lessons from a leper. Come on, let's celebrate the Lord one more time. You know, my brothers and sisters, I've discovered something, that ingratitude is an indication of immaturity. Infants don't always appreciate what parents do for them because they're born with short memories. And therefore, their concern is not in what was done for them yesterday, but what's being done for them right now. The past and future is pointless in their world because they only live for the present. But as they mature and matriculate through life, hopefully they'll learn how to appreciate what others and God is doing for them. Can I get a witness in here? And likewise, as we mature and matriculate in our faith experiences, we should get to a point where we can express our gratitude to God for all he has, is, and will do in our lives. And that, my brothers and sisters, is the real point of the pericope that we've tagged to teach today. Jesus was traveling alongside the border between Samaria and Galilee when he encountered 10 leprous men. They were hurting, alienated, rejected, and ostracized. Yet their encounter with Jesus changed the trajectory of their lives. They went from being misfits to being a good fit. And this story provides for us meaningful lessons on the importance of being thankful. Everybody can lodge a grievance. Everybody can lodge a mistake. Everybody can say what's not right. But there is power in being grateful. Do I have a witness in here today? There is power in knowing that God can, even if he chooses not to. Do I have a witness in here? The word thank actually comes from an old German word, thango, which literally means to think. Somebody say to think. Because whenever we're mature enough to think positively, we can't help but to think appropriately. That's what the songwriter meant, Brother Morris, when he said, "When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. I thank God for saving me." The idea of the song is, if we think about what Jesus did for us, then we will thank Jesus for who he is to us. Do I have a witness in here? Because whenever we think about how good God is, then, Brother Sherman, we'll thank God for his goodness. Whenever we think about how every morning brings word of God's faithfulness, then we will thank God for his reliable and dependable status in our lives. When we think about how his mercy arrives fresh every day, then we'll thank God for being a constant in our lives. When we think about how God has smiled on us when everybody else in our lives have frowned on us, then we'll thank God for his kindness. When we think about how his will is our peace, then we'll thank God for his stability in our lives. When we think about how Jesus stood with us when everybody else ran away from us, then we'll thank God for his friendship in our lives. When we think about how he kept us, then we'll thank God for his sustaining power. Brother Pastor, where are you going at? I just want you to know, when you think about what God has done, then you'll be able to thank God. When we think about how he led us over the tricks and the traps of our enemies, then we'll thank him for being our strength and our refuge. When we think about how he befriended us while smiling faces betrayed us, then we'll thank God for being a friend who sticks closer than a brother. When we think about others, how with others have been battered and bruised when they went through, but yet you came out not looking like what you've been through, then you will thank God for his arms of protection. When we think about how he helped us to reach the unreachable, manage the unmanageable, overcome the unbeatable, deal with the impossible, and remain kind in the uncomfortable situations, then we will thank God for his amazing grace. And I don't know who's in the room today. I don't know who's looking at me today, but you better get in a habit where you can thank God. You better get in a habit right in the midst of your hurt, right in the midst of your pain, right in the midst of what's going on, and throw your hands up and tell God, thank you. I may not be comfortable, but thank you. I may not understand it, but thank you. Do I have any grateful people in the house today, my brothers and sisters? And that is the cause and the reason for which we highlight the leper in our text, because he understood what it felt like to be thankful. This leper have a few lessons that he will show us today, and he'll teach us how we ought to react in the midst of our blessings and in the midst of our burdens. Because if God's got your back, it doesn't matter where life lands you. Do I have anybody in here today? If God's got your back, it doesn't matter what tries to come at you. I told the 5 a.m. people this morning, as Paul was testifying to Timothy, he said, every evil deed that comes up against me, God will cover me. And if you know God will cover you, then you better learn how to thank him. Lord, what should I thank you for? I thank you for your covering. I thank you for your protection. I thank you for your healing. I thank you for your deliverance. I thank you. Somebody in the Lord better start saying, Lord, I thank you. So here's the question this morning. Here's the question. What are the lessons to be learned from the leper in our text? What are the lessons? And I'm out of here. Last night, we had our floors done, and I'm high on fumes. But I told the Lord, if you stand me up here, I'm just going to preach it anyhow. So if you see me a little woozy, it ain't that I had some funny cigarettes, but I'm full of fumes. Here's the first answer. What does the leper teach us? And what will we learn from the leper in our text? Now, first, how desperate we were before we met Jesus. Come on, touch yourself and say, I was desperate. Verse 1 says, now it happened as Jesus went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. These 10 men were in a desperate situation. Leprosy, my brothers and sisters, was the most feared disease of that day. It was 10 times worse than COVID 19. Can I get a witness in here? It started with a little white patch on the skin, then eventually spread all over the body, which made this disease impossible to be hid. Lepers were called the walking dead. They were kicked out of their homes and villages and forced to live on a colony on the outskirts of the city with other lepers. They were shut off from their family and their friends. And in a sense, Brother Sherman, based on their ritual traditions, they were even shut off from God because they could no longer enter into the temple to worship. The good old church folks believed that they were incapable of having a right relationship with God since their suffering was a result of sin. But before I go any further, I want to tell you that their suffering had nothing to do with their sin. Just like what you're going through, it has nothing to do with some sin, because God's grace is too relevant in our lives to be stuck on something as silly as something you did wrong in your past. Can you imagine for just a moment? Can you imagine these lepers? They having everybody to turn their eyes in disgust whenever they saw them. Can you imagine having to depend on the pity of people in order to have enough to eat? Can you imagine having children pointing their fingers at you because you were uniquely different? Or can you imagine having ignorant people laughing at you and making side jokes about you? Leprosy was a humiliating and isolating experience, so much so that when they were sentenced to the leper colony, they were left there to die a slow, long, and horrible death. But my brothers and sisters, there's always good news in the story. You see, I told you that they were living horribly because all they were waiting for was for them to die. They left them on the side of the road. But the good news of the story is one day these 10 leprous men band together and decided not to give up and die, but to stand up and live. I could preach there if I had time, because so many of us, when we get declarations from other people, we decide to die. But when people knock you down, that's the moment you got to learn how to, I wish I had help in here today. But they decided to stand up and live. When Jesus entered into their colony, of death, defeat, and devastation, the text says that they cried out with one voice, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Boy, there's so much preaching in this text, because I like the first part. Jesus, did you know there's power in just that name? Did you know that demons must tremble? Oh, I ain't gonna get no help in here. But the text says that they cried with one voice, "Master Jesus, have mercy on me." And I want you to catch it, because they didn't ask for what they deserve, Sister Morris, but they asked for what they could never earn. Oh, that was something, Pastor. They didn't ask, Lord, to give them something they deserved, but they asked the Lord to give them something that they could never earn. They asked for mercy. Come on, somebody say mercy. Somebody say mercy. The Greek word for mercy is eleio. Somebody say eleio. That's the Greek word for mercy, meaning to help one who is afflicted. Now, it doesn't matter, Dr. Hines, because when I was putting this part of the message together, you came in my mind. It doesn't matter whether we speak the term Greek, the term mercy from the English language, or the term eleo from the Greek language. All both of them are verbs, but the way that the writer of Luke phrases the Greek word eleo makes the term an aorist active imperative verb. Oh, Pastor, you said too much. It makes it an aorist active imperative verb. The aorist meaning, for those of y'all taking notes, it means needing intervention right now. Oh, Lord, help me preach. The imperative conveys the urgency of their request, which simply means the writer of Luke wanted to convey to all of the readers and all who would read this story how desperate these leprous men really were when they were calling out to Jesus. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody in this room, somebody in the parking lot, somebody on Facebook need God right now. And you don't have time for a whole lot of words. You just need Jesus. Oh, Lord, help me, Lord. But the text says that instead of Jesus laying hands on them, you know how in some church services, all they want to do is speak in tongues and lay their hands on you. But Jesus gives us a good illustration. Don't you put your hands on nobody. Just send the word. Just speak the word. Let me show you in the text. The text says, instead of Jesus laying hands on them, when they cried out to him, Jesus just looked at him. Because let me tell you something, you don't have to act deep, you don't have to act big. If you got the power, all you got to do is look and declare, and God will make it right. I feel my help coming now. And the Bible says that Jesus looked at him and said, go and show yourself to the priest. Here's the context. I'm gonna preach in a minute, but here's the context. The Old Testament law required that a person who thought that they had been healed of leprosy had to first go to the priest for inspection, and the priest had to render the official proclamation. And since the 10 men who were leprous had already been declared as unclean by the priest, Jesus instructed them to go back. Who told you that you were dirty? Go back to the one that said you ain't worth living. And let me tell you what happened before I get too excited. Their faith in God, according to the text, as they were going, they were healed. I'ma help somebody. It wasn't until they stepped out on the word of the Lord. Woo! I feel it now. It wasn't until they stepped out on what Jesus said that they were able to experience the power of Almighty God. And all they had was just a word for somebody out there today. You want signs, you want wonders, but God has sent a word. Go, you're healed. Go, you are delivered. Go, you are set free. Yeah. Calm down, Curry. Let me help somebody. All they had was a word to step out on what Jesus said. And without seeing any evidence, they experienced God's power. All they had was a word. I'm kind of stuck there. All they had was a word, and they stepped out by faith, trusting and believing that God, if you said it, you're gonna bring it to pass. I don't know, I just met you, but something about that word that's ringing in my spirit. Something about that word that's got me wanting to get up and go to the high priest and let the priest know I have been healed. I don't look like it. I still look like the disease. I still look like the stuff that they said I was. But Jesus said to me, go, 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 go and show yourself. But wait a minute, wait a minute. They didn't have no visible, no physical or tangible evidence to support their step, because I've learned that faith is following when you don't know where. Faith is waiting when you don't know when. Faith is believing when you don't know how. Faith is trusting when you don't know why. I don't know why Jesus didn't just say you are healed, but Jesus sent them back to the place of their desecration. And I want to help somebody in here. Jesus said to you, go back to the place where they put you down. Go back to the place where they lied on you. And don't them see that you're healed, that you delivered, and that you're set free. Wait a minute. Faith. Faith. I'm trying to deal with this text. Faith. Somebody help me and say faith. Faith doesn't need evidence. Can I help somebody? It simply obeys the command of God. Why are you doing that? Because God said it. Why are you getting up? Because God said it. Why are you moving? Because God said it. You ain't got no money and you're still going to the supermarket. Why are you going? Because God said go. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Years ago, my pastor, the late Reverend Matt Yancey Jr. It stuck with me all these years. He taught his preachers what faith was. This is what he said. Faith is coming to the edge of all you can see and then taking one more step in the darkness, trusting that God is either gonna catch you or teach you how to fly. You didn't catch it, but I want to say it in another way. Faith is going in to a dark space. I don't know what the outcome, but I know God, and I know God will make a way. I know God will turn it in my favor. Do I have anybody out there today who took a step in the dark room and God, he turned it? But wait a minute, wait a minute. Not only, Brother Chairman, do we learn from the leper how desperate we were before we met Jesus. And just in case you forgot how desperate you were, I want to go to my second point, but I got to say this to somebody. You now be in the church. You now speaking in tongues. You now, all that stuff. But there was a time in your life where you were messed up. toe up from the flow up made everybody want to throw up. You weren't always as holy as you are today, but thanks be to God, when you met Jesus, he changed the trajectory of your life, and now you got a new song. I've been redeemed, I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. But let me move it just a little bit further. Not only are we taught how desperate we were before we met Jesus, but also what we gained since we met Jesus. Look at verse 15. Verse 15 says, one of them turned back and ran to Jesus and fell at his feet to give him thanks. My. Notice that this man didn't just want a religion, but he wanted a relationship, because falling at somebody's feet is a picture of submission and worship. When I tell you to lift up your hands, that's submission and worship. Do I have a witness? It was 10 who were exposed to the power of God, but only one sought a personal relationship with God. 9 were content to receive the blessing of God, but only one decided to thank the source of the blessing. And that's true in our day. Most of us want God to bless us retail, but we only want to thank him wholesale. But Psalms 107, it said, oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness and his wonderful works to the children of men. Yet the text says one leper went back to return, yet this one leper, he had desires. He wanted to go to his family. He wanted to show his friends. He wanted to show the world what the Lord had done. But he made up in his mind, before I praise my healing, let me praise my God. Do I have anybody in this place who can praise God for what he's done, for how he's blessed you, for how he's made way? My brothers and sisters, there's a theologian from the 20th century. His name was Ron Hatchcroft, and he said, hear these words: when we stop thanking God, we start forgetting God. A few weeks ago, the Lord just dropped this in my spirit. My daughter, I fried her some fish or something, I can't remember what it was. She was so excited about it that she started eating. I said, hold up, wait a minute, what's wrong, daddy? Hold up, you forgot to say thank you. Wait a minute, not to me, but to God. Because when you stop thinking about God, you gonna forget the one who gave you life. You gonna forget the one that gives you strength. You gonna forget the one who put food on your table. You gotta learn how how to thank God. And wow, wow, I'm almost done. Wow, this leper was worshiping at Jesus' feet. Jesus asked him a series of questions. He says, were there not 10 who were cleansed? Where are the 9? Didn't anyone come back except a foreigner? I could break that down, because this was a Samaritan, and some of the people who were healed were Jews. They knew that they were supposed to give God praise, but the one who weren't expected to come back came back to tell the Lord thank you. And I need somebody in this place, I don't know where you are, but lift your hands and tell them thank you. Thank him for what? You know your story. You know how he covered you. You know how he made a way. You know. Wait a minute. He asked him, Brother Chairman. He asked him, Brother Terman, he asked him, where are the 9? Where are the other folks? But I can see that old leper just trying to be politically correct. He didn't want to cut Jesus off. He just let Jesus ask all of his questions. Ask your questions. Where are they? But instead of answering, I can hear, as Rufus Johnson used to say, in my sanctified imagination, I can hear the leper saying, I can't speak for them, but nobody knew the pain I was in. Nobody knew the depth of my struggle. Nobody knew the humiliation that I carried. And since I've been changed, I can't worry about them. Somebody say it's personal. I can't worry about my neighbor. I can't worry about those around me, because God, he's been good to me. And I can see that old leper starting to get his praise and worship on, and he sang a song, glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burden down. He sang another song, you don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me. He sang another song, Lord, I just want to thank you. I want to thank you for all you've done. He sang another song, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I would be sleeping in a grave. But thanks be to God who has given me the victory. And I need somebody in here today. I need somebody in their car. I need somebody on Facebook. I need somebody on 28. I need somebody listening to me to thank God for life. Thank God for strength. Thank God for family. Thank God for friends. Thank God for enemies. Thank God for joy. Do I have anybody got a praise in your spirit? Do I have anybody got a worship in your spirit? Do I have anybody who know the value of praise, the value of worship? Listen, I'm done. I didn't have the clock on, so I can't tell you if I got any more time, but I'm done. Listen, listen, listen. You don't know You don't know what he's done for me. That's why it's personal. You want to get caught up in the 9 ungrateful people who did not show up. I want to thank God that I showed up. I want to thank God that I remember what he's done for me. I want to thank God that when I was on my bed, on my back, hurting everywhere, it was nobody but his hand that laid on my body and made me strong. Do I have anybody who went to your closet and you didn't have all of the things that you wanted in your closet, but God kept making a way? God kept turning stuff. God kept doing stuff. Yeah. So today, the lesson from the leper is very simple. We were desperate, but we found Jesus. Somebody ought to celebrate that right there. You don't know how desperate I was. That man's desperation can be seen, but how desperate I was may have been hidden, but it does not negate the fact that I was desperate. But wait a minute, he also wants us to know that we've gained so much since he came into our lives. Anybody gained since the Lord been in your life? You see life different. You see life better. You're stronger. You're wiser. Thank you, Jesus. So today is that day when I want you to lift your head, lift your countenance. We're getting ready to celebrate Thanksgiving. Before the believer, we give thanks every day. Not just one Thursday in the month of November, but we celebrate, we give thanks every day, 365 and multiple times within the day. We give thanks because we know that our blessings come from us thanking God. Any thankers in the room today? So today, the word of God to the people of God is that the leper decided to come back because he owed God a prayer.
I'm a crazy. This is a part of the book.
What would the lonely do?
Oh, don't do it! Oh God, what would they do? Oh God! Oh God, what did they do? What did I do? Kaelen, you know what I mean. Just think about it. What did I do at Christmas? Oh, God. Oh, God, it's, I love that Christmas song, but it's so sad. It's so sad. Whoa! What did they do? Right. What did they do? We rolling?
Oh.
Oh. Okay.
So how y'all doing? Me and Autumn are here today to talk about our upcoming production.
Yes.
For not cantata, because it's not really cantata. It's a production now. We've passed the cantata stage here. So it's called A Virtual Christmas,
with a question mark,
like how are we going to do this?
Yeah.
There is a lot of good singing, good dancing. We've got Pastor Curry doing a couple of dances. Pretty hilarious, I think so.
Yes.
Audrey can talk about all the dancing that she got going on.
Yes, so I have a little ballerina who's going to be featured in, yes, she is.
A little one.
Like, but she's a ballerina. She's going to be featured in our virtual Christmas production or whatever, however you say it. But anyway, and then we have a few different people that, you know, Ezine do know who will be participating in our dance. But it's going to be beautiful. It's going to be fun. It's different scenery. We're going to be, I don't want to give too much away, we're going to be everywhere, literally.
On the moon.
On the moon. Okay, watch us. We're going to be on the moon.
And of course, you'll hear some of your favorite Christmas songs.
Yes.
A lot of the songs have been rearranged by myself. There's one original song featured, and Pastor Curry did a narration for that. Mm-hmm. So it's It's going to be pretty dope.
It's going to be all
so
that.
You should come out. You can look, sit, watch it in your car.
Mm-hmm.
Come to the sanctuary. It's mm-hmm. going to be on a big screen.
Facebook.
Come into a theater near you.
Yes.
We just want you to come out and
yes.
be
come
a part
out.
Of it.
Be a part. Support us. You know, this is what we do yearly. So just, you know, just come out.
If you
want
to see Pastor Curry dance and Deacon Allen do a couple steps, this is your reason to come out because you will never see this again.
Facts.
Yep. Only for Christmas.
Only for Christmas. So, and also, we'll be able to, it's going to be on YouTube, right?
Yes.
It's going to be everywhere.
Yep.
It's going to be everywhere. And also, when you do see it on Facebook, share it with your friends, your family. Mm-hmm. It's going to be very, very nice.
And make sure you put I don't own the rights, because I do.
Yeah. Yeah, right. That part.
Uh-huh.
But here is a sneak peek
yep.
of
Enjoy.
Our production.
I can't believe this. I can't believe it. This is just unbelievable. You mean to tell me, look, this COVID thing has really created major problems for me, and this is the only thing that I really love. I love Christmas. I pastored this church for 16 years. We've always had Christmas. This doesn't make sense to me. This doesn't make sense to me. And I'm just really upset. I just cannot accept this. You mean to tell me we got people who cannot enjoy Christmas? We can't take care of our community. We can't do anything. This is just unbelievable. And I'm really not happy about this. This has created some serious problems for me. No Christmas? This is the happiest time of the year. We can give back to the community. This is crazy. What do you mean there is no Christmas? COVID, I understand we have been through a whole lot. I understand what's going on, but don't tell me to calm down. No, I will not calm down. We can't do nothing for the community. This is just bothering me. This is getting on my last nerve.
Hey, Christmas, Pastor.
Whatever, man, whatever.